to check how many Sundays we've been streaming now, but it is a lot. But the good news is that, well, good news for Victorians and Australians is that Victoria has now got 23 days of double donuts. No new cases, no deaths from COVID. And the other good news is that South Australia was worried about a second wave, but it looks as if it has been caught in its tracks. We don't catch waves in their tracks. Lots of good news actually in this part of the world. From midnight tonight, there's a big easing of restrictions, but by the time I got to church, the Premier hadn't reached the new restrictions for places of worship, so we have to look at that after the service finishes and see when it will be possible for us to meet again in this venue. What else has been happening this week? Well, we know, we are very aware that in the Northern Hemisphere here, for so many of those we love and care about and are related to by family ties, are having a much harder time. And you are very much in our prayers. We're also very aware that in Australia, we really, with some occasional protests which turn violent, we are living in peace. And we are grateful for that and never want to take it for granted. And frequently pray that God will bless the efforts of all those who work for peace and health. And of course the good news that's come to all the world this week is that it looks like we are getting ever closer to having COVID-19 vaccines available. So our gratitude to the scientists, the researchers, the governments who are supporting this research and who are trying to ensure, and Macron was the last one I heard speaking, that it's not just we in wealthy countries who have access to them, but our brothers and sisters all over the world, because we are all made in God's image and we all live on this planet and we need to protect one another. So now I will hand over to Graham. God bless you all.
Well, good morning and welcome to Blackburn Presbyterian Church. Thank you for joining us. If you've come via Facebook, please feel free to comment and leave a message for us so that we can respond. If you've come via the YouTube channel, then it's great to have you joining us. And I've been told this week that we have quite a few people who listen on SoundCloud and Audio Mac. So we're grateful for every person who tunes in and thank you for being with us, however you found us. Please feel free to use our webpage. On the front page of the webpage, you'll have downloads of this week's leaflet. In this case, I've put on the cover an image from Warren Brenninger, one of a Melbourne artist, who has several series of drawings entitled The Resurrection of the Living and the Dead. And I've put series 3, number 1, which has 440 images in it. This is image 4. So for your information, that's where the lead image comes from in our service today. Before we begin, we're going to have the usual elements. We're going to have Amanda playing the viola for us. The Bible reading today will be by Suzanne. Christine will bring Young at Heart, and I'll share from the great text of the Bible that we're looking at today, and this is indeed a great text. So let us begin with prayer. Shall we pray? Almighty and everlasting God, we seek to draw near to you in this time of worship and adoration. And our prayer is that as we do so, you will draw near to us. Whatever our external circumstances, we ask that you will nourish us through the Holy Scriptures. and strengthen us by your Spirit as we are led into the truth as it is in Jesus, for whom we thank you and whom we seek to honour in our time together now. Amen. Well, right at the beginning, we've been having a musical piece from Amanda on the viola, and today she's going to play Bach's Prelude in G major, a very beautiful piece. Thank you, Amanda.
Week, I should have mentioned, we're aware that for some people the sound goes too low, so we're trying to have the mic closer to our mouths. Okay, Young Heart this week decided on the topic floating and having faith. Now, as you know, we were in the water at Port Fairy, South Beach, the week before last. It's a beautiful beach. And unlike some of the Port Fairy beaches, it's very good for swimming, not for surfing. Further around, it's very good surfing, but my surfing days as they were, which was what I call second-hand surfing, because I caught the wave after it broke, those days are behind me, and I just swim and float. I love swimming in the sea, but possibly I even more enjoy floating. I find it so relaxing to have the water holding me up. And given that, like many people my age, I have aches and pains in many joints, I just love lying there thinking that every joint, every vertebra in my spine is finding its allotted space. Now, those who know me well know that I'm not by nature a courageous person. I'm not a risk taker. And I have friends who are much more courageous than I am. And yet, some of them would probably never walk into the sea, and they certainly would never try to float. What makes the difference? Lots of factors, I'm sure, but maybe primarily the fact that I've had decades of experience of seawater and water in pools, but I particularly like seawater, just of water holding me up, and it's never let me down yet. I'm very grateful to my father, who taught me to swim. I think I was about 7, I meant to check that detail with my sister. I think I was about 7, and we were on holiday in a part of the west coast of Scotland called the Kyles of Bute. Very cold water, but he taught me to move through the water. I think I then learned the strokes, possibly at school. We had a fortunate, we were in a fortunate position of being a state school with a swimming pool. At times of stress and discomfort, and at any time really, being in water is for me a great solace. And one of the things I most missed in lockdown was that I couldn't have my thrice weekly visits to the hydrotherapy pool nearby. Many people my age in the UK didn't learn to swim, so I'm doubly grateful that I did. Anyway, why all this talk about me and water? Well, as I float and trust my body totally to the water, I think of the parallels with learning to trust ourselves totally to God. And that, I must admit, comes less easily to me. In fact, one of my favorite verses perhaps is, "Lord, I believe, please help my unbelief." John Peyton, who lived from 1824 to 1907, a Scot, in 1858, so when he was about 34, travelled to what was then called the New Hebrides, now called Vanuatu. And you can see where Vanuatu is on this map. And interestingly enough, although he went from Scotland to Vanuatu, he actually came back, he retired to Australia, retired from overseas missionary work anyway, and it's a long tradition of the Peyton family working for the Kingdom of God in Australia. He believed that God called him to Vanuatu to tell the people about Jesus. As well as preaching, he developed small industries for the local people, such as hat making. That was new to me, and so was this. He advocated very strongly against a form of slavery which was practiced then. It was called blackbirding, and it involved kidnapping local people and forcing them to work in New Zealand and elsewhere. He's often held up as an example and an inspiration for missionary work. The islanders at that time were cannibals. Nobody trusted anybody else. John himself was in constant danger. He had come to share the good news about Jesus. He wanted to translate John's gospel, firstly, into the local language. But he discovered there was no word for trust, belief, or faith. One day, when his indigenous servant came in, Peyton was sitting, working at translation. He lifted both feet off the floor and asked, "What am I doing now?" In reply, the servant used a word that means to lean your whole weight upon. This became the expression that Peyton used. Faith is leaning our whole weight upon Jesus. Now the next and the last photograph is me not doing what John Peyton did. I'm not sure I could now sit in a chair and lift my feet right up. But I'm sitting, lying on and trusting my whole weight to what is called a zero gravity chair, which was the gift I received from PLC staff when I retired way back in 2008. I have to say grandparents, grandchildren probably sat on it more than I have, but I plan to spend more time on it reading. Anyway, perhaps we could go back to the one of the Vanuatu map. Early in the Old Testament, believers are encouraged to trust God totally. In Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 27, they are told, "The eternal God is your refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms." I always liked that verse, but it came to mean even more to me during an assembly at PLC when a former colleague who is still a dear friend spoke at the assembly we were going to lose her. And she recovered, and she wanted to take an assembly and thank all the staff and girls who had supported her with their prayers, with loving messages, and so on. She had a brown paper bag and took from it samples of the letters and cards she had received. But she also said that even through the depth of her illness, she always knew that underneath were the everlasting arms holding her up. So, whether you and I, whether we trust water to support our bodies or not, may we all learn to lean our whole weight upon Jesus, confident in those same strong, loving arms.
Circled by four living creatures and the elders. The Lamb had seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. He went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. And when he had taken it, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. Each one had a harp, and they were holding golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of God's people. And they sang a new song, saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth." Then I looked and heard the voices of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and elders. In a loud voice they were saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever." The four living creatures said, "Amen," and the elders fell down and worshipped. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
And we add our amen as well. Thank you, Suzanne. Great text of the Bible. This is the concluding address in this series. Next Sunday starts Advent, and I'm hoping that we'll be turning our attention to the promise of a Messiah and a Savior as we come close to Christmas. But the passage that we're looking at is Revelation chapter 5. I'm actually going to comment briefly on Revelation 4 and 5, both of these chapters. And I want to begin in a place that you might not expect. I want to begin with an English poet named Wendy Cope. She's a contemporary English poet. I think she may be quite well known in the United Kingdom. I heard that she had been touted as a possible poet laureate, so I assume she's well known there. But I want to recite a poem of hers called "The Present." This is about a gift she received, and the poem explains itself to some extent. on the flyleaf of my confirmation present, to Wendy with love from Nana, Psalm 98. I looked it up eventually, Cantate Domino. I knew the first two verses and skimmed the rest. 35 years afterwards, at evensong on day 19, the choir sings Nana's psalm. At last, I pay attention to the words she chose. O sing unto the Lord a new song. Nana, it's just what I wanted. O sing to the Lord a new song. What new song was it that Nana's was directing her granddaughter to on her confirmation? Well, we can only speculate, but if we follow the Bible trajectory and begin with Psalm 98, we might find some of the clues in today's great text from the Bible. Because as you heard Suzanne read a few moments ago, it brings us to a rising crescendo of songs, three songs, each one increasing in participants. How do we get there? Well, if we turn to John chapter 4 and verse 1, now we're going to be considering how John takes us to that singing. And the first thing he does is that he takes us to an open door, John chapter 4, verse 1. And then as we look into chapter 5, we come to a sealed scroll. And then, look, there's a lion, but a lamb. And then finally, the universal singing that I have already alluded to. So let's use these headings and turn our attention to this passage of Scripture. First of all, then, an open door. If we go through this door, we find ourselves in what might be called the command center of the universe. In John's vision, of course, it's described as the throne room of God. John is very interested in thrones. He uses the word 47 times out of 62 in the whole of the New Testament. So a lot of emphasis on the throne, who reigns. Revelation is a kind of coded writing. I need to warn you of this. Without this code, of course, some of the things that John shares from his visions would have opened him to the charge of sedition or possibly treason. It's difficult, but not impossible for us to understand. We need to remember that Revelation uses symbolic language. A lamb with seven horns and seven eyes, you understand, it's hard to visualize. So the language is symbolic. Not every detail should be pressed. And it's tragic, I think, when you see people who have a drawing which tries to press all the detail. In the throne room of God, we're told, John will see what must happen after this. That is, in John's time and beyond. What will happen? And here, right at the start of this chapter, we're reminded that life is not at the mercy of blind fate or random chance. God is always in control, no matter how we feel about things. And because we know we won't always feel good about that, we are reminded in Paul's letter to the Romans, for example, that God has intended to work all things for good to those who love him. So the control room of the universe is an extremely sensitive place, and sensitive to you and to me, and we need to understand that love is on the throne. The throne is surrounded by four awesome creatures and a circle of 24 lesser thrones with elders on the thrones, and the details are unimaginably incongruous and symbolic. Think, for example, about a rainbow the colour of an emerald. Can you imagine that? I don't think anybody can. A rainbow the colour of an emerald. What are we talking about? Where does all this language come from? Well, it's informed by moments of the Old Testament. In particular, for example, Exodus chapter 19, the cloud and the mountain, and the trembling and the thunder. It's informed by Ezekiel chapter 1. You remember the prophet has this vision of wheels within wheels while he's by the Kibar Canal with the exiles in Babylon. It's informed by Isaiah chapter 6, where the prophet is awed by the cherubim and the seraphim around, surrounding the throne of God, and God visits him in his need and forgives his sin. These are the visions that inform John's vision as well. And the four living creatures worship God the Creator. So chapter 4 is about the worship of the Creator. And the 24 elders cast their crowns before the one on the throne. In other words, their authority is derivative. It is the one on the throne who is in control. They are dependent on him, and their authority comes from him. We may speculate, we're not told specifically, but the 24 elders very likely represent the 12 tribes of Israel and the work of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. So we have, as it were, symbolic numbers representing the Israel of God in olden times and in the modern times. Later on, if we read Revelation, we'll discover that the holy city is built on the foundation of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. And these elders acclaim him worthy, and they worship the one on the throne in their singing. But then something else appears on the screen, as it were, in the vision of John, and it's a sealed scroll. It's in the right hand of the one on the throne, in chapter 6, chapter 5, verse 1. Unusually, it's written on both sides, and it's sealed with seven seals, as if it could only be opened partially, and then a bit further, and a bit further again. And again, the number seven is symbolic. You can find it's used as a structural feature in the book of Revelation. It's used 36 times in the book. There are seven churches early in the book of Revelation, seven seals, seven trumpets, seven bowls, seven angels, just to mention the more obvious ones. And scholars generally take the view, as Leon Morris expresses it, great Melbourne theologian of yesteryear, that the scroll contains the world's destiny, and that the contents of the scroll are revealed to us in the pictures as the seals are opened. In other words, the book of Revelation reveals the unfolding of the scroll. But no one can open the scroll. Professor Tom Torrance, of Edinburgh fame, says, "The secrets of the world belong to God, and no man can pry into them. Who knows what a day or a night might bring forth? Who knows what this year holds in its dark, unknown future? Even the strong angels of God are unable to open the book. Only God can unseal the seals and read the secrets of men." And so John sheds tears because there is no one worthy to open the book. And then there is a secret. What is needed is not strength or power to break the seals. You pick it up in that last sentence, there's no one worthy to open it. This is goodness, the criteria. We're looking for somebody who is so good that the history of humanity can be entrusted to that person. There's no one good enough to open the scroll, no one to be trusted with the human story. But stop. Look. What do you see? Well, John is told to look and see the lion, but as he turns to see the lion from Judah's tribe, it's not the lion that he sees. He's turning to see Jesus, the Jew. You should remember that the word Jew comes from Judah. And so here is the lion of the tribe of Judah. It's not an often used expression, but in Deuteronomy, we're told that Judah is a lion's cub. And from the tribe of Judah came Jesus the Messiah. Just in case you are uncertain, Jesus has featured as central in John's visions from the very beginning. In Revelation chapter 1, verse 1, it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. So to refer to the lion of the tribe of Judah as Jesus is precisely what one should expect. Jesus of the line of David is here presented as triumphant. He is qualified to open the scroll. So John turns But it's not a lion that he sees. What he sees is a lamb. And it's in the center of the throne. And it's a lamb as it had been slain. John is not viewing a dead lamb, but one that was dead, but is alive forever. I think we find that expression in chapter 1 of the Revelation, verse 18. So it's already there, right from the start. And now we're being taken into the throne room, and we see that this one who was dead and is alive forever has the worthiness, the goodness to be entrusted with our history. Now the Lamb is mentioned many times in the book of Revelation. In fact, it's mentioned 31 times in the book. Why this emphasis? Because the victory of the Lion of Judah is achieved by self-sacrifice, like a lamb to the slaughter, as Isaiah 53 has it. What is accomplished by this death? Well, the answer is in the song of the creatures that follow. By his blood, a transaction has taken place. The word is, he has bought. He has bought them for God. He has purchased the people. His death erases their sin, and they become God's people. By dying to redeem those who were his enemies, Jesus has triumphed. What kind of Christians are we? Does the lion or the lamb best represent our image to the world? This is a question we need to ask ourselves personally, but also as a church. Are we sort of triumphers? Have we perceived that the triumph of Christ is achieved through the service of humanity? He gave himself for us. We need to be careful about this, because there's a great danger that we assume a triumphalist attitude. What the death of Christ has done in purchasing these people for God is that he makes them a kingdom. Is there under his authority and priests. The kingdom of God was Jesus' great theme, and as believers we submit to his authority. Our wills should yield to his, like the 24 elders. We cast our crowns at his feet. We're captive to him. Also, all Christians are priests in the global enterprise of God. Each of us is an intermediary between our fellow human beings and God in two ways. Firstly, we represent God to the world. And when we fall down in that, the world despises our God. So we need to be careful how we walk, how we represent God in our living. But also, we represent our fellow men and women before God. They are in our prayers. We lift them to God and ask for his mercy and his grace to flood into their lives and bring to them the joy of his salvation. And our prayers for others, feeble as they may seem to us, are cherished by God. They're depicted in this vision of John as in the golden bowls in the hands of the elders, if you read the text carefully. Your prayers are not lost. They don't go into some cosmic black hole. They're in golden bowls, and they're held by the elders before the presence of God. They're precious to him. And it's at this point, as the Lamb becomes the vision of John, that the singing begins, and it's universal singing. Now, there are several ways my mind went as I wanted to share with you the power of song. I wanted to share with you the question that Ernest Shackleton asked every man that he took to Antarctica with him before the First World War. The question was, can you sing? If you want to know more about that, I recommend the book Shackleton's Way by two women who studied him as a leader. And they saw that the importance that he put on singing, especially among a group of men. But I decided another story can teach us a lot about singing. And this is the story of a man called Rick Rescorla. Rick Rescorla was born in Cornwall, and he served in the British Army But as a small boy in Cornwall, there were American troops there, and he always wanted and aspired to be part of the American army. And so eventually he did migrate to America and was enlisted in the American army and served in Vietnam with some distinction. But after that war, he became a safety officer, a security officer and a safety officer for the Morgan Stanley Bank. Rick Rescorla was located on the 44th floor of the South Tower of the World Trade Center. He saw the plane crash into the North Tower, and he was shocked to hear a public announcement advising South Tower personnel to stay calm and remain at their workstations. Previously, to the great inconvenience and annoyance of many of Morgan Stanley's personnel, Rescorla had often practiced emergency evacuations off the cuff. Now, using a megaphone, he defied the instruction to remain, and he ordered all personnel to immediately evacuate. Crowds of bank personnel began descending the many flights of stairs to the ground. In order to reduce panic, Rescorla started singing. Through a megaphone, he sang the Welsh marching song, Men of Harlech. Crowds of bank employees began descending. Once he had safely escorted these crowds to ground level, Rescorla re-entered the building to bring others up. He phoned his wife. He told her that he loved her, that he was happy, and he wanted to reassure her of that. And he also phoned a friend because he knew his wife was finding it difficult. And he asked his friend to contact his wife and to help calm her. He was in the second tower when it collapsed. He gave his life to his task as safety officer. His body was never recovered. Rick Rescorla is credited with saving the lives of 2,687 people. He's rightly honored for his sacrificial commitment to others. As Christians, we see in Jesus the sacrificial commitment to the whole human family. He gave himself for us. And Jesus, the Lamb, as it had been slain, comes into the vision of the three doxologies, one after the other, in our great text this morning from verses 9 through 14. In the prime of life, Jesus gave himself, as the old hymn has it, in Scottish hymn indeed, Christ is the world's redeemer, he gave himself to save a world undone and suffering for the sinful. He full redemption won. John sees and hears the singing of the 24 elders, the foundations on which all of God's revelation rests. He hears the singing of millions and millions of angels. The expression is using the maximal term that they could refer to in numbers in the Greek language at that time. And eventually, every creature on heaven and earth is singing the praise of Jesus. The church has always sung the praise of Jesus. I perhaps shouldn't tell you this, but my computer in front of the camera right here is mounted on 6 12 hymn books. That's the only way we can use them at the moment. We're not allowed to sing. One of the ironies of COVID-19 is that singing spreads the virus, and we are encouraged currently not to sing, but we do look forward to being able to sing the praises of the Lord Jesus together in due course. American Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann says, eventually our voices must break beyond the narrative testimony, that is the storytelling, or explanatory theological formula, the statements that we use of faith, to something else. What is it? He says, to lyrical self-abandonment. That's what we're hearing from the elders, from the angels, from the whole creation in the end, forgetting itself and looking at the one alone who is worthy. Self-abandonment. Beautiful, lyrical self-abandonment. The dominion of the Lamb will supplant and replace all other things. The Lamb, his goodness, is key to world history and to human destiny, including yours and mine. Amen. Let us join in that universal song, and now let us proceed to our prayers. Let us unite our hearts as we come before God in prayer. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain and has redeemed us to God by his blood. Lord Jesus, Messiah, with the 24 elders of John's vision, we abandon ourselves to your will and purpose for us. We cast our crowns at your feet. You are our King. With untold millions of angelic beings, and with every creature in the entire universe, we want to lose ourselves in lyrical self-abandonment to declare that you alone are worthy of praise and honor and glory and might forever and ever. We are your servants. Guide us by your Holy Spirit to commit each day to the concerns of your kingdom. Forgive our earthly conceit and vainglory, and shape our lives as servants of the Lamb who was slain, that we might daily pursue your will and be increasingly fruitful in your service. Guy, thank you that in Australia we are blessed with a system of checks and balances by which federal and state governments are answerable through the media to the public. We're conscious of the great cost and effort that has been made to protect us from COVID-19. With the interests of the most vulnerable in mind, may they continue to work for the common good. As restrictions are easing, we pray that we will continue with good hygiene and health practices. We ask the elderly in particular will be able to safely receive visits from family and friends over the Christmas and holiday season. May the arrival of loved ones evoke memories of your advent. Thank you for the great work that has been done in many places to create an effective vaccine. We ask that as these come online, they will benefit medical personnel and the most needy. We ask that the poor and vulnerable in places where the virus is still rampant will be offered vaccine protection. In Australia, we are deeply ashamed that some among our armed forces in Afghanistan have killed innocent non-combatants in the war there. Please forgive them and forgive all of us. As processes are in train to try and right the wrongs, we pray that the bereaved will sense our national contrition, that the criminal behaviour of the few will not negate the dangerous and sacrificial service of many, that justice will be tempered by mercy, and that those who first raise concerns will be honoured, not prosecuted. Again, we pray that the hostages, Ken Elliott and Leah Sharibu, will be released and returned to their families. We know that injustice, hatred and violence are ending. We pray for those who have experienced trauma and loss as a result of evil perpetrated by either individuals or corrupt regimes, especially this month in Mozambique, Colombia, Sri Lanka, Nigeria, Uganda, and Iran. Thank you for those who brought the message to us and for the remarkable work of John G. Payton. We remember innumerable others who have left the comforts of home and loved ones in your service. As COVID has forced us all to learn skills in virtual and online communication, we ask that this too will carry forward the message of Jesus. These things we ask in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Saviour, who taught us to pray together and to say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you for being with us. May the Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he keep you in the whole.